Dear students and my teacher friends, Namaskar. I welcome you to the presentation lecture on other factors affecting the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen. Now, first of all, let's understand the title of today's lecture. So, this is the title. Now, see, affinity means attraction. So, affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen. So hemoglobin is having affinity for oxygen. So generally we have seen that oxygen combined with oxygen bind with the hemoglobin. But it is not that the only oxygen bind with the hemoglobin. There are some other factors, they can also bind with hemoglobin. And so which are the factors that bind this hemoglobin, that we are going to discuss in this lecture. So here first we need to understand some numbers. Okay, see, when we inhale, the atmospheric air travels through the respiratory tract and the air enters into the alveolus of the lung. So this is the alveolus is shown, and in the alveolus the air which is there, in that air oxygen is present, and the partial pressure of oxygen in the alveolus is 105. In some books they are writing 104, so it's okay, but here we are using 105 number. Okay, so partial pressure for oxygen is 105 mmHg, and this one is the respiratory membrane between the, so the wall of alveolus and the wall of pulmonary capillary, they are involved in the formation of respiratory membrane. We have already discussed this thing, respiratory membrane, and this one is the pulmonary capillary. Okay, so in the blood which is present in pulmonary capillary, blood that arrives in pulmonary capillary, that blood is having partial pressure for oxygen 40 mmHg. So now as the pressure gradient has developed from the alveolus, this oxygen diffuses into the blood of pulmonary capillary. So now as more and more oxygen is diffusing into the pulmonary capillary, so the pressure for oxygen inside the pulmonary capillary rises up. Now due to the high pressure, the oxygen loads, oxygen enters into the erythrocyte and it binds with the hemoglobin. This is called the loading for oxygen in the hemoglobin. Okay, now where this pulmonary capillary blood is going, so we know pulmonary capillaries, there are the network of pulmonary capillary, all this capillary they join together, they form venule joint, and they open into the pulmonary vein. So there are total 4 pulmonary vein, we know that, and this pulmonary vein, they are pouring the blood into the left atrium. Okay, so the left atrium, the blood is oxygenated. Here the blood, this blood is oxygenated. Okay, and it is having a pressure of 100 mmHg. So PO2 is 100 mmHg. Now we know that why this pressure is 100 mmHg in left atrium. What is the reason? So it's not that only the direct blood is coming. Okay, it is not like that. See, the pulmonary vein, they receive blood from conducting zone, and the air which is present in conducting zone, okay, they are not participating in the gaseous exchange. That's why instead of 105 the pressure is 100 mmHg for oxygen. Now where this blood is going, from left atrium the blood enters into the left ventricle, then the systolic contraction of left ventricle, blood enters into the aorta, then aorta, there arise various arteries. So in our arterial blood, the pressure the pressure is 100 mmHg for oxygen. Now we know in our body, from the arteries there arise the arteriole, okay? So in arteriole also the pressure is 100 mmHg, and from the arteriole there arise the capillaries. So these are the systemic capillary. So in the systemic capillary also the blood pressure for oxygen is 100 mmHg. So these are the numbers that we are keeping in mind, okay? Now the other factors that we are talking about that affect the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen, okay, and this factor, they are changing. What happened? They are changing the shape of hemoglobin, so hemoglobin cannot hold oxygen, and the oxygen unloads from hemoglobin and oxygen enters into the tissue cell. So these factors are, one factor is temperature, okay? Due to the high temperature, hemoglobin cannot hold this oxygen, okay? So due to the high temperature, oxygen releases from hemoglobin. Then second factor is the pH of the blood. Third factor is the carbon dioxide, and the fourth factor is BPG. So we are, in this lecture, we are discussing all these factors one by one, okay? Now I would like to show you one more figure so that you will have the idea about this. So over here you see this figure, okay? Now this one is the systemic capillary, or we can say this one is the tissue capillary, okay? And this one is the erythrocyte is shown, and inside the erythrocyte you can see the hemoglobin, and oxygen has combined with the hemoglobin. Now at the tissue level, what is happening? So this oxygen is unloading and oxygen is entering into the tissue cell, okay? But how this happen, how this oxygen enter, or why this oxygen enters into the tissue cell, that is the question. So there are factors. For example, let's say in the tissue cell, what is happening? Cellular respiration is taking place, and in the cellular respiration, at the end of cellular respiration, ATP production is there and CO2 is produced. So this CO2 diffuses from the tissue cell and it enters into the blood. And where it is going, this CO2? So this CO2 enters into the erythrocyte, and in the erythrocyte there is hemoglobin is present. So this CO2, when combined with hemoglobin, so oxygen is released from hemoglobin, and that oxygen enters into the tissue cell. This is one factor. So we can say when partial pressure of CO2 increases, that time also oxygen unload, okay? Or we can say when CO2 enters into the blood, that time O2 enters into the tissue cell, okay? Then second factor is the acidity. So in the tissue cell, as more and more acid are produced, so we know when the acids are dissociated, one ion that is formed is the H+ proton is there. So this H+ ion, since the acids are formed in the tissue cell, this H+ diffuses in the blood, okay, and they combine with the hemoglobin. So when this H+ join with hemoglobin, that time also this oxygen unload and enters into the tissue cell. And third factor is the temperature, okay? So when the body temperature increases, that time also hemoglobin cannot hold oxygen, and the oxygen unloads and enters into the tissue cell, okay? So this is the glimpse of the lecture that I have given to you, and we are discussing all this thing in this lecture, okay? So this is the figure, this is the main figure, okay? So with this figure you will have the complete idea what is happening. This is the second point. So now we are discussing the second point of our lecture, acidity or the pH. Now, you have idea in the chemistry, you have learned about the pH scale. Okay, pH scale, we are knowing pH scale is from 0 to 14 is the pH scale. Now, pH 7 means neutral, and 0 to 6 pH, that means acidic pH, and 8 to 14 means basic pH or the basic environment, and 0 to 6 means acidic environment. So as the acid production in the cell increase, okay, so there is an inverse relation between the acid and pH. So as more and more acid are produced, the pH is going to decrease, and if there is a less acid production, pH is going to increase. That way you can understand this thing, okay, because in the acid, when the acid, generally the acid dissociate, and there is a formation or there is a release of H plus from the acid. So in other word, we can say when the amount of H plus increases, that time also the pH decreases. So that is the meaning of this thing. So here they are writing that when the acidity increase, the pH decrease. That is the meaning of this thing. And as the acidity increase, as the concentration of H plus increase, the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen, it decrease. So oxygen dissociates from the hemoglobin, and oxygen readily enters in our tissue cell. Okay, so in other word, we can say that increasing acidity enhances unloading of oxygen from hemoglobin. So higher the amount of acid, higher the concentration of H plus, so the there will be enhancement, or the tendency of oxygen will be that it will it will detach from the hemoglobin, and it will enter, the oxygen will enter into the tissue cell. Okay, now the main acids which are produced in the tissue cell due to the metabolic reaction, these acids are the lactic acid and the carbonic acid. These are the main acid which are present due to the metabolic reaction or the activity inside the tissue cell. Now moving forward, discussing the third point. So this is the third point. So when pH decrease, now the when pH decrease, that means more acids are present, more H plus are present in the tissue cell, that time the oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve shifts towards right. Now in the figure I will show you what is the meaning of this thing, oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve shift to the right. In the figure I will show you, in the graph I will show you, okay. And this thing, this shifting, in that the pressure, partial pressure of oxygen is not related. So for any partial pressure of oxygen, this thing is going to happen. That means the when pH decreases, that time oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve is going to shift toward right. Okay, and when pH decrease, that means more acids are there, that time Hb is less saturated with oxygen, and that means the oxygen is now going to dissociate from the hemoglobin, and this Hb is going to enter into the tissue cell. So this effect is known as the Bohr effect. So we are not going to pronounce as Bohr effect, but we will pronounce as Bohr effect. Okay, so what is, once again, what is Bohr effect? pH decrease, oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve shifts to right, and here the pressure, partial pressure of oxygen is not important, whatever the pressure of oxygen is there, this thing is going to happen when pH decreasing. Okay, so hemoglobin cannot hold the oxygen, so oxygen is going to dissociate from, oxygen is going to separate from hemoglobin, and this oxygen is going to enter into tissue cell. This effect, this change is known as the Bohr effect. Okay, so in the curve or in the graph, I'm showing you this thing. One minute. This is the graph, and you see this graph. Okay, so first, what is this graph? So on x-axis, the partial pressure of oxygen is written. Okay, partial pressure for oxygen is increasing, and here on y-axis, hemoglobin saturation percentage are written on y-axis. Okay, now you see the pH numbers are written. For example, pH 7.2, 7.4, 7.6. Now, let's say we are at this point, PO2 is 40 mmHg. So now I am showing you this. Okay. Let me draw this. This way and this way. Okay, one minute. Okay, and we are keeping the same pressure. So this time we are reaching at this point. Okay, and we are moving forward then this time. Okay, so you see what is happening. So pressure is same, 40 mmHg for oxygen, and pH you see 7.2. so decrease in pH, less pH is there, lower pH. At lower pH, hemoglobin saturation is about 50. Okay, then let's say the pH is 7.4, so that time around 70, and pH 7.6, so that time what is happening? The saturation for hemoglobin is increasing. So as we are, see, 7 point, instead of 7.2, let's say pH is 7 6.8 6.4. okay, so I'm decreasing the pH. So when we join the points, so you see what is happening. So as pH decrease, this curve hemoglobin oxygen dissociation curve is bending towards right. Okay, so as there is a further decrease in pH, what is going to happen? This percentage are going to decrease. That means hemoglobin saturation is going to decrease. More oxygen is going to unload from hemoglobin. That is the meaning of this thing. Okay, and the pH is increasing. So let's say pH becomes 7.8, 8.5, 9, 10. And as the pH is increasing, so what is happening? That means the hemoglobin saturation is also increasing. That means more and more oxygen is going to load into the hemoglobin. So this is how we are going to read this graph. Okay, and here all the information, this information you can read. Okay, this information is important for you. This you read. I have tried to explain you, and this information, okay, this information you read. Then this information, all this point we have discussed. Now you need to read these points. Then here also the Bohr effect. So this point also you go through. Okay. So coming back to our discussion regarding the pH. So we have discussed in the third point, we have discussed the Bohr effect. Now this Bohr effect, works both the ways. Both the ways means there are two ways that the Bohr effect can work. One way is, see, increase in the concentration of H plus. So the H plus concentration increase in blood, it will cause more O2 to unload from hemoglobin, because H plus is going to bind with, H plus is going to join with hemoglobin, and that time O2 is going to unload from the hemoglobin. Okay, then binding O2 to hemoglobin, if oxygen, vice versa, if oxygen pressure, if there is a good pressure, partial pressure of oxygen is good, let's say in the pulmonary capillary there is a high oxygen pressure, okay, more and more oxygen is diffusing in pulmonary capillary, that time what is going to happen, this this oxygen is going to bind with hemoglobin, and at this time there will be unloading of H plus from hemoglobin. Okay, so the explanation for the Bohr effect is that hemoglobin can act as a buffer for hydrogen ion. So whenever there is a requirement in our body, so that time the hemoglobin can bind with H plus, and at the same time hemoglobin is also in a position to detach H plus, to remove the H plus. So that is the meaning of this thing, that the hemoglobin can act as a buffer. It can receive H plus and it can throw away, or it can dissociate, or it can unload the H plus also. Okay, that's why HB is acting as a buffer for H plus. Now what exactly happen when the H plus concentration goes up? So this H plus, they bind to amino acid. We know hemoglobin is protein, and there are four polypeptide chain, two are alpha polypeptide chain and two are beta polypeptide chain. So in this polypeptide chain, amino acids are present, and this higher concentration of H plus is there. So H plus joins with the amino acid in the hemoglobin. And once this H plus joins with hemoglobin, what happened? They are altering the structure of hemoglobin slightly. Okay, so as the structure of hemoglobin has altered slightly, what happened? This hemoglobin loses the capacity to hold the oxygen. So there is a decrease in oxygen carrying capacity of hemoglobin, and this oxygen unload from the hemoglobin. So in short, we are remembering this thing, that the concentration of H plus increases, that time H plus joins with hemoglobin, and that time O2 is unloading from hemoglobin. Okay, then the lower pH drives O2 off from the hemoglobin, and this thing, due to this, as more and more O2 is uploaded from hemoglobin, so more O2 is available for the tissue cell, and this O2 is entering in the tissue cell, and it will participate in cellular respiration. Now In contrast to this, if the pH is increasing, elevated pH, so that time hemoglobin will be having more affinity for oxygen. So if hemoglobin saturation for oxygen increases, the curve is going to, that the curve means oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve is going to shift towards left. Okay, so all the theory points we have discussed, and I have shown you the graph also, and one more graph I would like to show you for this pH effect. So this is the graph that you can go through. Okay, we have discussed 1, 2, and 3 point, and one graph I have shown you, and this one is the second graph. Okay, now moving on the fourth point of our discussion. See, so now we are discussing the partial pressure of carbon dioxide. So as the concentration, as the amount, as the proportion of CO2 increase, so this CO2 increase, so the more CO2, if cells are producing more number of CO2, so the effect of elevated CO2 level is same, that is for H+. What is the meaning of this thing? That as the more and more CO2 is produced in the cell, this CO2, see, I'm showing you, for example, this is, let's say this is the tissue, these are the tissue cell, okay, these are the tissue cell, okay, these are the tissue cell, and this one is the systemic capillary, okay. Now here in the tissue cell, due to cellular respiration, CO2 is produced, okay, and this CO2, due to the pressure gradient, this CO2 enters into the systemic capillary, and here in the systemic capillary, as the CO2 concentration is increasing, this CO2, where, what happens in the RBC, this CO2 enters, okay, and this CO2 is going to join with hemoglobin, and this hemoglobin, so earlier it was having, it was in the form of HbO2, so this hemoglobin, since now the carbon dioxide is joining this hemoglobin, so it can not hold this oxygen, so oxygen is releasing, and this oxygen is going to enter into the tissue cell. Okay, so that's why they are writing that CO2 also can bind to hemoglobin, and the CO2 is having the similar effect that of H+. That means when CO2 join with the hemoglobin, the curve is going to shift right, and when curve, we have seen in the graph, then when the graph or the curve shift toward right, that means the hemoglobin saturation for oxygen is going to decrease. Okay, so as the partial pressure of CO2 risen up in the tissue cell, okay, and this CO2 going to diffuse from the tissue cell into the capillary blood, systemic capillary, so this CO2 joins to hemoglobin, and hemoglobin is going to release the O2, and this O2 is diffused, and it will enter into the tissue cell to participate in the cellular respiration. Okay, so CO2 and the pH, they are the related factors. Okay, and how they are related, so that thing we are going to see. we are trying to understand how the CO2 and pH are related factor. So when the CO2 in the tissue cell or our body cell, CO2 is produced, so this CO2 enters into the blood, okay, and Then this CO2 enters into the RBC. So inside the RBC, this CO2 combines with water. So CO2 joins with water in the presence of enzyme carbonic anhydrase. So due to the presence of this enzyme, CO2 and H2O join and H2CO3 is formed. So this is the carbonic acid, and this carbonic acid is going to dissociate into H plus and HCO3 minus ion. So as the acid, carbonic acid is formed, more H plus ion are going to form. So we can say more acid is formed, more H plus are formed. That means the pH is going to decrease, and we know when the pH is decreasing, the the curve shifts towards the right direction. Okay, see, so all this thing that we are discussing, so the carbonic acid thus form in RBC, okay, dissociate into hydrogen ion, bicarbonate, this thing we have discussed. Then the H plus concentration increase, pH decrease, okay. So increased pH will produce acidic environment, this thing we have discussed, okay. So O2 is released and it is entering into the, where this O2 is entering, so this entering into the tissue cell, okay. Now when we are exercising, during exercise, lactic acid is produced as a byproduct of anaerobic respiration. So what happened when a person is exercising, that time generally in our muscle the aerobic respiration is going on, cellular respiration is aerobic time, okay. But when person is exercising, that time what happened, the muscle cell, the muscle fiber, they require more oxygen, and the body, the capillaries, systemic capillary, they cannot provide sufficient amount of oxygen to the muscle cell. So it is not that the when the person is going when the person is exercising, that time the due to since the cells are deprived of oxygen, oxygen is not entering into the muscle cell, that it is not that the muscle cell are going to die. So the muscle cell, they will take the another route, and the another route is the anaerobic respiration. The muscle cell will start anaerobic respiration when there is no availability of oxygen. So in anaerobic respiration, the lactic acid is formed. So lactic acid is acid, okay. So when the lactic acid is formed, as the lactic acid amount is increasing, so that time also what happened, the pH is going to decrease, okay. And pH decreases, that means the shift of graph, okay, will be right side, okay. And vice versa, in the contrary to this, if the PCO2 decreases, so the saturation, if PCO2, if less CO2, if let's say the less amount of CO2 is entering into the blood, that time what is happening, so the O2 is remain in the combined form with hemoglobin. O2 is not going to dissociate, okay. So if there is a decrease in partial pressure of CO2, so that time the saturation curve will shift toward the left direction. So for the effect of CO2, I'm showing you the graph. For example, in this, see, pressure of CO2, 80 mmHg, so you see, okay, this position, then pressure of CO2, 40 mmHg, so as the pressure of CO2 is decreasing, the oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve, you can see it is shifting toward left side, okay. This, so let's say this is the 80, okay, PCO2 80, then PCO2 40, then here 20, and let's think about the hypothetical situation that it will become 10, 5, 2, then all this curve, they are shifting toward left side. Okay, that means when the curve shift toward left side, that means hemoglobin is more saturated with oxygen. And when this curve they shift toward right, that means the hemoglobin saturation is going to decrease. Okay, so pressure, in short, the pressure for CO2 increase, there is a decrease in hemoglobin oxygen saturation percent. Okay, one more graph. See this graph. Okay, now we are moving on the fifth point. In this point, we are going to discuss about the temperature. So temperature is also having the same effect that the H plus and the CO2. Okay, that means when the temperature increases, our body temperature increases, so that time also O2 is released from hemoglobin. Okay, and heat, what is heat? See, in our cell, cellular respiration is going on, metabolic activities are going on, and due to the cellular respiration, there is a production of ATP and CO2 gas. And it is not that all the energy which is liberated in cellular respiration, all the energy is not going to capture in the form of ATP. Some energy is going to liberate in the form of heat. And this heat which is liberated in this cellular respiration, this heat is responsible for our body temperature. So our normal body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. And why our body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius? Who is maintaining this temperature? So the heat which is liberated in the cellular respiration, that liberated heat is maintaining our body temperature. Okay, so we can say when the temperature is high, that time the oxygen is going to release from the hemoglobin. Now when person is exercising, okay, vigorous exercise, let's say in the gym a person is doing vigorous exercises, so that time he will be contracting more and more muscle fiber. Okay, so that means more and more oxygen is entering into the muscle cell, more and more cellular respiration is going on, and more heat energy is liberated. So that time in the person body, there is a rise in body temperature. And as the temperature rises up, the oxygen is released from the hemoglobin. Okay, so metabolic active cell, they require more oxygen and they produce more acid and the heat in the cell. Okay, so the formation of acid in the cell and the release of heat, they promote the release of oxygen from oxyhemoglobin. Similar situation during the fever, when the temperature in the body rises up, so similar effect is observed. So due to in the fever situation, okay, let's say the person is suffering from some kind of disease, and that time the body temperature has risen up, so more and more oxygen is going to release from the hemoglobin, and this oxygen enters into the tissue cell. Now in contrast to this, during the hypothermia, that means the lower body temperature, So the cellular metabolic activity, cellular respiration, and other metabolic activity, they are slow. So in this case, in this situation, the body cell, they require, the requirement for oxygen is reduced. Okay, less amount of oxygen is entering. So now in this case, more and more O2 remains in a bound form with the hemoglobin. So in this case, the saturation curve is going to shift toward left. Okay. So in the figure, I am showing you the effect of temperature. So here, this one. Okay. So see, this one in the black color, this is the normal blood temperature, 37 degree Celsius, 98.6 Fahrenheit. Okay. And when the temperature increases, that time you see what is happening. Hemoglobin oxygen saturation percentage decline. Okay. And at lower temperature, the curve shifted toward left. That means hemoglobin oxygen percentage, saturation percentage are high. Okay. So with seeing the graph, we can see that as temperature is increasing, the curve shift towards right, and there is a decline in hemoglobin oxygen saturation, and vice versa, when the temperature lower up, that time the curve is shifting toward left, so that time hemoglobin is more saturated with oxygen. More oxygen can combine with more oxygen can combine with hemoglobin. Now we are discussing the fifth point, and in the fifth point we are discussing about BPG. Now what is BPG? The full form for BPG is 2,3 biphosphoglycerate, that is BPG. Okay. Now earlier this BPG was known as earlier it was known as DPG, diphosphoglycerate. Okay, and what this DPG is doing? So this DPG is decreasing the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen. So once inside the cell, more and more BPG is produced. So oxygen is going to release from hemoglobin. So we can say oxygen, as the amount of BPG increases, as BPG rises up, there will be unloading of oxygen from hemoglobin. Now, what is this BPG? Let's understand how this BPG is formed in the cell. So, BPG is formed in the RBC. Okay, and in the RBC, when the glycolysis process is going on, means glycolysis, we know it is the first phase of cellular respiration. Okay, and in glycolysis, ATPs are produced, okay, and not directly. I know that the oxidative phosphorylation and electron transport chain are there, but anyway, we can say that here they are writing, so because it will divert our discussion, the cellular respiration, the stages, and you have studied this. In fact, you have I have delivered the lecture on glycolysis. So if you haven't seen that, you can see this, and you can go through this lecture. And in that lecture, with the chart, I have explained that the intermediate product of glycolysis is the BPG. Okay. So here we are remembering this, when BPG, more amount of BPG is produced in the RBC, so that time the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen is declining, decreasing, and more oxygen is going to unload from hemoglobin. Okay. Now, see, BPG what this BPG is doing. So this BPG combined with hemoglobin, and it is joining to the terminal amino group of the polypeptide chain. Which polypeptide chain? The 2 beta, there are 2 beta globin chain. So in short, this BPG joins with the beta globin chain, and that time the hemoglobin cannot hold this oxygen tightly, so the oxygen is released from the hemoglobin. Okay, so oxygen leaves the heme group, oxygen is detached, and this oxygen will enter into the tissue cell. So we can say the greater the level of BPG, more O2 is unloaded from hemoglobin. Then certain hormone, for example thyroxine, this human growth hormone HGH, epinephrine, norepinephrine, testosterone, they also increase the formation of BPG. Okay, then the level of BPG also it is higher in which the people they are living at high altitude. High altitude means the people who are living let's say on the mountain, or they are living in the hilly areas. So in the hilly areas or the mountain region, what happen, there is a less availability of oxygen, the pressure of oxygen is low. So that time in those people, this amount of BPG rising up. Okay, so they will be suffering from the condition that the oxygen is unloading from hemoglobin. Okay, so high altitude more BPG is produced. Now the final point of our discussion, and this point see, now we are discussing the oxygen affinity of fetal and adult hemoglobin. So basically here we are discussing fetal means the baby which is developing in mother's uterus or mother's womb during 9-month pregnancy, that baby, developing baby, that means the fetus, and the adult hemoglobin. So here adult hemoglobin means the mother. So among these two, the fetus and the mother, whose hemoglobin is more capable to hold the oxygen, okay, or whose hemoglobin is having more affinity towards oxygen, that thing we are going to understand. So now this fetal hemoglobin during the pregnancy, the fetal hemoglobin is different from the mother's hemoglobin. Fetus hemoglobin is known as HbF, and mother's hemoglobin, that is the adult hemoglobin, is known as the HbA. And there is a slight change, slight different in the structure of both the hemoglobin. And the fetal hemoglobin is having a high affinity for oxygen. Okay, and mother's hemoglobin is having less affinity for oxygen. Okay, now this fetus hemoglobin is having higher affinity for oxygen, and that's why it is there are lesser chances that it is going to bind with BPG, because it is having higher oxygen affinity, that's why. Okay, so when the pressure of oxygen is low, okay, the fetus hemoglobin can carry up to 30% more oxygen than the maternal hemoglobin. That means even if the pressure of oxygen is low, what happens? At this lower oxygen pressure, maternal hemoglobin is going to release oxygen, and at this time the fetus hemoglobin is going to capture 30% more oxygen. Okay, so in short we can say the fetus hemoglobin is more efficient to capture the oxygen, to bind with oxygen. Okay, now we know between the fetus and mother there is a structure known as placenta. Okay, so the mother's hemoglobin is not having much more affinity for oxygen, so mother's hemoglobin at placental level, mother's hemoglobin releases the oxygen, and this oxygen is transferred into the fetal blood circulation, and this oxygen immediately it combines with HbF. Okay, so that is the meaning of this thing. So that's why they are writing that this is very important, because the O2 saturation in maternal blood in placenta is quite low and fetus might suffer hypoxia. So this is the another condition. One condition we have discussed. In short, what they are trying to tell us that fetal hemoglobin is having more affinity for oxygen, mother's hemoglobin is having less affinity for oxygen. So at placental level, this mother's hemoglobin is releasing oxygen, and this release oxygen immediately binds with fetus hemoglobin. Okay, when this oxygen crosses the placenta, that is the meaning of this entire discussion. And vice versa, see, one more condition they have written over here. See, this is very important thing, because the O2 saturation in maternal blood in the placenta is quite low and fetus might suffer hypoxia where it is not greater affinity of fetal hemoglobin for oxygen. Now what is the meaning of this thing is that, see, if the condition arise that this mother's hemoglobin is not removing the oxygen sufficiently, so this oxygen cannot cross the placenta, and the fetal hemoglobin is not receiving the sufficient amount of oxygen, that time the fetus can suffer from the condition known as hypoxia. Okay, so at this time the pregnant mother should be provided with the artificial oxygen, so that as the extra in the condition, if the baby is suffering from hypoxia, mother should be administered with the oxygen. Okay, so this extra oxygen that supplied to mother will increase the pressure of oxygen in the alveolus, so more oxygen is going to bind with hemoglobin, and when the blood reaches to the placental level, so more oxygen is released and more oxygen will be available to this developing baby or this fetus. Okay, now one graph is there, so see over here they are showing the pressure of oxygen, here the hemoglobin oxygen saturation percentage are shown, and this is the fetal. Okay, so fetal hemoglobin has a higher affinity of oxygen, okay, than the mother's hemoglobin. Okay, so this is the oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve comparing fetal and mother. So with the dotted line you can see the curve for the fetal is shifted toward left, and for mother it is shifted toward right. So that means the fetal hemoglobin is for the same pressure, let's say if we draw a line over here, okay, at any point you can observe this. See, if at any pressure if we draw, so we can see that the pressure is same, but you see, same for same pressure of oxygen, maternal blood is less saturated for hemoglobin, and fetal blood is more saturated for oxygen. Okay. So with this we have completed the discussion. Okay. And before I wind up this presentation lecture, I would like to show you all the figures. I have already shown you, but let's say, so this figure I have shown you. This is the first figure, okay. Then this figure. And this figure. This way. So with this we have completed this presentation lecture. I hope you have enjoyed this presentation lecture, and I also hope that this presentation lecture will be helpful in your exam preparation and also in your studies. My name is Manish Koshi sir. I am from Ahmedabad, India. Bye bye. Namaste.